broadcast tonight Dan Rather on his exclusive interview with President Clinton.
So he's aware that he has a reputation of, in the end, maybe playing a little soft. Maybe he can, in Washington terms, quote, be rolled from time to time. He wanted to knock that right in the head. He talked about resolve. He talked about determination.
And from the State Department, the Assistant Secretary of State, James Rubin.
What we've seen in the last few days, the results of President Milosevic's offensive operation, has only redoubled the determination of the president and the leaders of NATO to continue this air campaign and, as you said, to expand it to make sure that we are able to meet our military objectives, and that is to disrupt and damage his ability to conduct these offensive operations.
A program note, Jeff Bezos of Amazon.com and Peter Newport of Drugstore.com were scheduled to be on this evening. They will appear on this broadcast on Friday night. Tonight, Dan Rather in his interview with President Clinton all about Kosovo. Also on the same subject, James Rubin of the State Department. And three guests take a look with analysis. All of that when we continue.
Anywhere, anytime, any book. BarnesandNoble.com, where the world shops for books.
Cisco Systems, the company that brought the internet to business, is pleased to help bring The Charlie Rose Show to PBS. Cisco Systems, empowering the internet generation.
Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide. Studios in New York City. This is Charlie Rose.
We began this evening with Dan Rather, the CBS News anchor and 60 Minutes 2 correspondent. This afternoon at the White House, Dan Rather conducted an interview with President Clinton, the first interview the president has done in more than a year. They talked about many matters, including Kosovo. Here is the report by Dan Rather on the CBS Evening News.
Tonight, from the White House, one-on-one with the Commander-in-Chief, President Clinton vows to press on with the air war against the Milosevic government as long as it takes.
We live in an age where everybody wants things to operate like a 30-second ad. This air campaign is not a 30-second ad.
And as thousands more Albanians flee Kosovo, the president says NATO could not have prevented the vicious ethnic cleansing.
Mr. President, there are reports that as we speak and through this evening, that there will be air attacks in Belgrade itself, that you've gotten NATO to authorize it. Is that correct? Is that accurate?
It is accurate that we are attacking targets that we believe will achieve our stated objective, which is either to raise the price of aggression to an unacceptably high level, so that we can get back to talking peace and security, or to substantially undermine the capacity of the Serbian government to wage war.
Does that include attacks now in Belgrade? In the vernacular of the military, have you authorized them to go downtown?
I have authorized them to attack targets that I believe are appropriate to achieve our objectives. We have worked very hard to minimize the risks of collateral damage.
Joining me now, from Washington, the Washington Bureau of CBS News, Dan Rather. Dan, thank you for joining very much. It's a pleasure to have you on the broadcast.
Always a pleasure to be with you, Charlie.
Before we begin talking about this important interview today, what do we know about this late-breaking story, three soldiers on the Macedonia border who appear to be missing and may be have engaged in a firefight with Serbians?
Well, we don't know a lot, Charlie. The facts are few about this. The picture, as best we can get it from various sources, but it is, I emphasize again, not double confirmed. This was a three-man patrol along the Macedonian border with Kosovo. On which side of the border they were, we're not absolutely certain. The presumption is that they were on the Macedonian side. They were on patrol, and they were last heard from saying that they felt they were surrounded and they were... It was incoming small arms fire. Now, that much has been pretty much confirmed by the Pentagon. There are unconfirmed reports, and I underscore that word, unconfirmed reports that they may have been, quote, kidnapped or, quote, taken hostage. Frankly, I don't know anything about that, and having our at least two-source rule at CBS News, we are not reporting that. We do know that, you know, there's this observing force in Macedonia that patrols have to be out as part of their protection, of course. There's a lot of other things patrols are out to do. We don't know what this particular patrol was doing. The U.S. did send a warning to the Serb forces very recently that they should not be firing or take any hostile acts against these patrols. Now, that's as much as we know. I think it's going to be quite a while before we know very much more than I've just told you.
But if it turns out that these Serbian soldiers have somehow held Americans captive, this is one more example of ratcheting up the conflict over there and action and reaction.
Well, if that turns out to be true, absolutely no question about it. It would be roughly in the category of downed pilots. Of course, we had one aircraft down, but they rescued the pilot. And I wouldn't rule out the possibility that if, and we're pretty far afield here, these three on this patrol have been taken captive, if that turns out to be the case, I wouldn't rule out the possibility they could be rescued. We'll just have to see.
What important things did we learn from the Commander-in-Chief today with respect to NATO and American intentions with respect to the bombing and how they see it proceeding?
Charles, I think the reason President Clinton did this interview with CBS News today was that he wanted to communicate, first of all, to the American people, secondly, to the NATO allies, and thirdly, perhaps most importantly, to Milosevic and his people, his resolve, that President Clinton's resolve. I think that was number one. You know, he's aware that he has a reputation of, in the end, maybe playing a little soft. Maybe he can, in Washington terms, quote, be rolled from time to time. He wanted to knock that right in the head. He talked about resolve. He talked about determination. Also, I think he wanted to communicate that he has both the patience as well as the will to ride through an extended air campaign. Although it was very telling, Charlie, that when I pressed him about the use, possible use of ground forces, he said, and this is not a direct quote, but it's almost direct, he said, you know, I chose my words carefully about that. A president should choose his words carefully about it. I have no intention of using ground troops. That's as much as I'm going to say. Then he followed up and saying, I have confidence in our present strategy. If we stick with it, again, paraphrasing him, if we stick with it, if we don't lose our resolve, if we stick with this air campaign, I, the president, think it can be successful. I think those are the most important things he said about the war itself. He said some other important things, that we have not changed our policy about Kosovo being independent, that our policy, as you know, has been, and President underscored today, remains, that we want Kosovo to be at least a semi-autonomous part of the Yugoslavian whole with its own government, but not an independent state. He underscored that a couple of times.
That's probably a message to Milosevic.
Absolutely.
When you look at the mindset with the president, do you get any feeling about what they do if the bombing does not work?
No, quite honestly. And let me say that while under repeated questioning, he would not confirm that targets in Belgrade, in the capital, in Belgrade itself, have now been okayed. He certainly left a very clear impression by saying, we do have approval, our armed forces have approval to hit those targets necessary to the success of the mission. That if the targets in Belgrade were not hit tonight, he certainly laid out the high probability that they will be hit. But in answer to your question, and this was asked directly to him, that he hasn't decided on the next step, because his message today and tonight was, I, the president, believe this air campaign will work if we stick to it. But he went on to say time after time, and I think that's an apt description, that he is determined that the mission be accomplished. And the mission is that Milosevic get his forces out of Kosovo, and that the Albanians are allowed to come back and to operate with some degree of autonomy and freedom within Kosovo. Charlie, the message, a very strong message here was, he believes in this air campaign, and he wants to continue it. Now, it's report to you that there are any number of people around the Pentagon, whether they tell the president or not, I don't know, but they tell others, they don't think that we're fully employing our air power, and they are frustrated that the president and the NATO leadership haven't, in their terms, really turned them loose.
But the argument that we are hearing also is that the United States is urging a more intensive use of air power, reflecting, I guess, the Pentagon opinion within the councils of NATO.
No question about that in my mind, Charlie. And if you listen to the president all the way through this interview, as I did today, there's no question in my mind that that's true, that the United States is pressing for, you know, more targets, a more active air campaign, and that the NATO leadership is wary of that. I think in the background, Charles, we know the Italians and the French particularly are increasingly nervous about this air campaign. And what the president's trying to do, he's trying to hold a 19-nation alliance together. That's going to be increasingly hard as time goes on.
Any sense of a recognition that the world's most powerful alliance and the most powerful air force from the United States cannot afford to be helpless in the face of the defiance of a dictator from a small Balkan country?
Well, obviously, the president is very aware of that, and I think it came through in the interview that he's very aware of that. That here we have the most powerful air force in the world with the most powerful military alliance in the world. And so far, up to and including this moment, they have been unable to get the dictator of a small Balkan country to do what they want. The president's message today was, patience, don't give up on this air campaign, it will work. We shall see. As you know, there are an awful lot of people, including military people, who don't believe you can do it with air power alone. And then there's the question always that we have tremendous technologically sophisticated weapons, but when you're dealing with a dedicated ground force fighting on its home ground in hostile terrain, sometimes, no matter how much air power you use, it doesn't work. I'm not saying it won't this time. I am saying that the lesson out of history is sometimes it doesn't work. Now, in fairness, Charles, at the start of the war against Saddam Hussein, they were running as many as 200-plus bombing sorties on the first day, for example. In this campaign, despite all the talk from NATO and from our own Pentagon, there hasn't been a single day when we've had as many as 50 actual bombing runs. There have been other sorties. So it is true to a degree that we haven't leveraged our full air power. And I think the problem, this is my opinion, the problem lies with the NATO leadership of saying, well, let's hold off and not really use it. Let's don't drop the full hammer down.
All right, let me come to other issues. How much time did you have to prepare for this? I mean, when did you know that this was going to happen?
Well, got a call last night from Joe Lockhart at about 8:30 New York time. And so obviously we went right to work. But Charlie, you as one of the best interviewers here or any place else knows that for a big interview, you're always prepared. You're always working in your head saying, well, if it comes about, how would I ask the questions? What questions would I ask? I've been doing that for not just weeks, but for several months.
You had about the same amount of time you had before the Saddam Hussein interview, as I remember.
Well, that was even less time. Yeah. But listen, I'll take it this way anytime. Always glad to have it.
Beyond Kosovo, he clearly wanted to send messages, as you suggested. What else did he say about Mrs. Clinton running for the Senate, about his support,
well,
about the possibility of the damage to the marriage, et cetera?
Well, you know, Charlie, I didn't know going into this interview whether the president would talk about any personal things, family things, his place in history, that sort of thing. I rather suspected that he wouldn't, but he did. This interview was about two-thirds about the war and about a third about his place in history. He surprised me. Perhaps he said it before, but I don't think so. He said he never for one instant gave any thought to resigning. And that the First Lady had never even talked about it with him, never even suggested it to him. He said things such as he does not agree that the first paragraph of his obituary is going to necessarily mention that he was the second president in history to be impeached. He talked about Mrs. Clinton and the Senate race, didn't announce that she's going to run in New York, but you can't listen to him and what he said tonight in our interview and not know that she is at the very least seriously considering making the race in New York, whether you think it's a good idea or not. I thought he was very forthcoming on the personal legacy, where he stands in history, how he feels about the impeachment and the mess of the last year and a half. I thought he was very forthcoming on that, and that surprised me.
Man, thank you so much. We're running out of time here. I appreciate you taking time on a busy day to talk to us about an interview seen earlier this evening on 60 Minutes 2. Dan Rather, correspondent, 60 Minutes 2, CBS Evening News. Thank you. My pleasure.
Thank you, Charlie.
We'll be right back. More conversation about Kosovo. Kosovo is at the top of the news today. As efforts to stop the conflict continue, NATO decided to expand airstrikes in Yugoslavia to new targets, including Yugoslav government buildings in central Belgrade. Meanwhile, more refugees poured out of Kosovo into neighboring Albania, Montenegro, and Macedonia. Joining me now from Washington to talk about the strategy to stop the crisis, James Rubin, Assistant Secretary of State. He, as many of people know, the spokesman at the State Department who has been briefing reporters and answering questions about where we are and where we're going, which is exactly my first question. Where are we and where are we going?
Well, clearly it's a very difficult time right now, Charlie. The reports of what's going on in Kosovo are truly horrific, whether it's mass execution, forced expulsion for people from their homes, reports of rape, or just the simply the hundreds of thousands of people that have been displaced and the 100+ thousand people that are now in Albania having been forced out of Kosovo. I think what we've seen in the last few days, the results of President Milosevic's offensive operation has only redoubled the determination of the president and the leaders of NATO to continue this air campaign and, as you said, to expand it to make sure that we are able to meet our military objectives, and that is to disrupt and damage his ability to conduct these offensive operations.
So tell me how will you know when you have met your military objectives and therefore you can stop the bombing?
Well, the easiest way to stop the bombing would be if President Milosevic were to reverse course, if he were to stop the offensive and pursue a peace process based on the Rambouillet Accords. But if that doesn't happen, then the military will have to make an assessment of whether we have been able to seriously damage his forces. Right now, we are expanding the target list. We're moving to a situation where in the early days of the campaign, only a small percentage of the targets were actually the concentrations of Serb forces in Kosovo, and now some 50% plus of the targets are actually those forces or supplies for those forces, ammunition or command and control facilities that are able to conduct this operation. It'll be a military assessment as to whether the serious damage has been done, but it would be much preferable, I think, for everyone concerned if President Milosevic were to reverse course and stop this terrible offensive he's conducting against the people of Kosovo.
And it would be fair to say tonight it looks unlikely that he is going to do that. There's no indication that he's going to do that. He is defiant, and he is, in fact, increasing the level of violence in Kosovo.
I think it's fair to say that he's not done it yet. You know, different people were trying to interpret what it was that he was trying to signal in the meeting yesterday with Prime Minister Primakov, and whether he was trying to signal something there. I know people have had different views on that. But regardless of what his intent was, the proposal that he put forward yesterday fell far short, was woefully inadequate from what we've been looking for, and therefore we're determined to keep this up until we've damaged his forces severely. And it's hard to know what is going through his mind and what will happen in the future, but we know this, is that we could not stand by and let President Milosevic and the Serb forces conducting this terrible offensive act with impunity. And we want to make sure they pay a heavy, heavy price for it.
It becomes very confusing. I mean, you said we want to make sure they can't act with impunity because there's a moral issue here as well as other issues. And so he's got to pay a heavy price. It's almost sounds like if we want to send the message, we at NATO want to send the message that if you act like this, whether it is ethnic cleansing or whether it is simply a code of conduct that violates the notion of what is appropriate between nations or within nations of a civil war, that it can't go unnoticed and we're not going to stand for it.
Well, yes, I think that is part of the message here. On the other hand, the message is a very concrete one, which is that our airplanes and bombers and are going to go through a serious military campaign to actually try to destroy certain capabilities and severely damage others so that this offensive is brought to a halt.
Do you think the military has the notion of a level of destruction that will bring Milosevic to a table or to an agreement that would be satisfactory?
I don't think anybody can know an answer like that. I think what we need to bear in mind is that there really weren't that many options. We had the option of standing by while this offensive was conducted. And let's remember, for the last 14 months, he's been ethnically cleansing Kosovo. Hundreds of thousands of people were in the hills last fall. Thousands of people have been killed. We could have just let that go on. Alternatively, we could have pursued a massive ground campaign, but the president made the decision that he has no intention to send in ground forces and all that goes with that. Or we can pursue air power and try to make sure that we deter, and if that doesn't work, then severely damage his capabilities. Those are the choices in the real world, and I think the choice we selected was the best of three relatively bad alternatives when you're dealing with a dictator of this kind of behavior in Europe in 1998, 99 now.
A lot of people look at where we have been and they say it seems that we keep changing the definition of what we want. In the first place, we wanted him to sign on to the agreement at Rambouillet, and now it seems to be just stop the level of violence, or now it is that we will make a determination from the military standpoint, when we have done serious damage to his capacity to wage war.
Let me distinguish, and I can understand people who don't follow it closely, but there's a difference between political objectives and military objectives. The political objectives are to try to get President Milosevic to reverse course and to stop the offensive and to pursue a peace process. That's our political objective. But if that doesn't happen after all of the work we did at the negotiating table and it became clear that he was negotiating while the offensive was being conducted, we had to act. And having acted, we have different objectives. Those are called military objectives. And in the first instance, they were to deter the expansion of the offensive. And if we couldn't deter it, to severely damage his capabilities. That's what you can do with military power. So we've tried to be clear on what our goals are over the long term, but also to be clear as to what military force can do and what our objectives for it are.
There seem to be also these ideas out there. Number one is that, and tell me whether it is absolute, we have grossly overestimated the power of air power.
Again, I think that people who know about this recognize the limitations, but the people who have to make decisions, rather than the people who get to look back and say how smart they would have been, or they're faced these three options that I described to you, to stand by and do nothing, to send in a massive ground force, which the president says he has no intention of doing, or to act the best we can, united as an alliance of 19 countries, with a massive use of air power, knowing that that is not a sure thing, but knowing that we're determined to see it through to its conclusion.
What was the mindset? The mindset, I assume, was once he sees that NATO is serious and they are prepared to bomb, then he'll come to the table or he'll change his course.
Well, I think people hoped that would happen. I think that was reasonable to hope that would happen. I think everybody hoped that would happen. Probably a lot of Milosevic's advisors hoped that would happen. We even have indications that a lot of Serbs had hoped that would happen. But that doesn't mean we expected it to happen. We know that this is a brutal dictator, and that if the pressure of military force wasn't going to convince him to sue for peace and to pursue peace seriously, then nothing was. And so it became clear after pursuing peace for many, many, many months and many weeks where the Secretary of State was involved, that they were talking at the table while pursuing an offensive on the ground. And that was simply unacceptable.
Did we realize or appreciate the impact this would have among the Serb people? Whether they liked Milosevic or not, they seemed to be rallying to the side that opposes any of this bombing and perhaps unwittingly being supportive of him for his defiance.
I think people expected there to be a certain rallying around the flag, as would occur in any country in the world. I think what's unfortunate here is that the Serb people don't have access to information. They don't get to watch a show like yours or watch any of the other networks or read real newspapers. They get disinformation every day. And that was true throughout the conflict in Bosnia. The Serb people were presented with grossly distorted images and grossly distorted facts. We've tried to break through that with some of our modern technologies, but it's very difficult when the only television you see all day and the only newspapers you read all day have this disinformation and propaganda. I think when you catch people who have access to the outside world, you find they're less supportive of what Milosevic is doing and more, if not supportive, at least understanding of why NATO is acting.
How about among the refugees who are having to flee because of what's taken place today?
Well, Charlie, this is an area where I tell you, if there's one silver lining for those of us who are out there every day trying to explain this policy and know the difficulties and have to answer the hard questions, there have been some rather dramatic statements by the people who are actually suffering the ethnic cleansing, and I think they're the greatest validators and provide the clearest testament to the wisdom of this policy. And they're saying, if NATO didn't bomb, the Serbs would have done this to us anyway. That is their view.
There's no question in your mind about that. People who are having to flee their home because what the Serbs are doing now. Not that they hadn't done it before, but because of the NATO bombing, there's no question that they say, we understand the bombing, even though we had to leave our house, and even though, you know, we don't know where we're going, we're sleeping out in the forest, we understand.
The reporters on the ground are doing a brilliant job in bringing to bear first-hand accounts from the people who are actually suffering, not the armchair strategists in Washington at the think tanks, the people who are actually living this policy. And they are saying very clearly, the Serbs were going to do this to us anyway, and at least now they're paying a price. We've heard phrases like, NATO's bombing when we're sitting in our homes and hiding and running away is music to our ears. And I think that is powerful testament that this policy, although not satisfying right now, is the right one in the long term.
It is my understanding we have not ruled out the introduction of ground troops, even though it's unlikely, even though we expect to do it. It has not been unequivocally ruled out.
Well, all I can do on a show like this, in this forum, Charlie, is to repeat what the president has said, and that is that he has no intention of sending ground troops unless and until there's a peace agreement to implement.
So if someone makes a powerful argument that there is no way to bring Milosevic around except the introduction of troops, and air power without troops will fail, unless there's a peace agreement, according to today's policy, there will be no introduction of troops.
That's what the president has said, right?
Are we going to face a risk here of this thing spreading?
We believe there was a risk of this spreading as a result of President Milosevic's policies. Look, we understood that an offensive was going to begin this spring. That's why we were working to pursue a peace process during the winter. After the situation in the fall where 250,000 people were sent fleeing from their homes, we tried to work through the winter, which is not a time when military action normally takes place, to try to work on a peace process. And ultimately, the Serbs refused to pursue that seriously. And we expected this spring to have an offensive, and we're now seeing it. And that offensive always entailed the possibility of refugees fleeing into Macedonia, Albania, and Montenegro. We now have some 160,000 refugees in those three countries. And that's why the president has now put into action an emergency plan to get relief supplies to these people. He's just authorized another $50 million to be spent. The Pentagon will be flying in relief supplies, tents, sheeting, and other material like that to try to stabilize the situation and make sure the presence of those refugees does not destabilize those three countries I mentioned.
Will that do it?
Montenegro.
In your judgment, that will do it?
Well, we're going to work at this. We do not want to see this conflict spread. One of the reasons that Kosovo matters to the United States is that this region matters to the United States, and stability in this region, like stability in Europe, is an interest, a vital interest of the United States. And so we're going to work on that very closely. NATO has been in touch with the countries in the region. We have a dialogue with them. And we're going to work to try to ensure that, that there is no instability and that it doesn't spread beyond, obviously, the refugee crisis.
There is this report coming out of Washington from the Washington Post and the New York Times, and one or the other or both, that the United States within the councils of NATO has been the nation pushing hardest for expanding and making more intensive the air attacks. Can you confirm that?
Well, the United States has been a leader in this process. We've worked very closely with our NATO allies. When you're dealing with 19 countries, 18 other countries, there is a certain amount of give and take. But we're very pleased that last night NATO decided to expand the target list and to make sure that those facilities that are involved in directing or supporting the offensive that is going on in Kosovo are no longer going to be immune from NATO attack.
When you leave government and you are asked to comment on important events at the time, do you think you'll be able to look at this and say, here is, I know what the mission was, I knew what the end game was, I knew exactly what the strategy was, and I think we had the right tactics, and we knew exactly what we were doing, and people who were trying to analyze this thing didn't quite get it at the time?
Charlie, these are questions for hindsight, and I understand that someday I'll be able to have hindsight. Right now, we're engaged in the real world, and we're trying to make real world decisions without the benefit of hindsight.
Okay, that leads me to this important question. What is it that we don't know that you guys, and I mean all of you, and the Secretary of State, and the Secretary of Defense, and the President, and the National Security Advisor, everybody involved in one way or the other in this, what is the important thing for you, for us to understand, who are looking at it from afar?
I think the point is pretty simple. We don't have that many choices when we're dealing with a brutal dictator like this, and that we could stand by and let this happen for years the way it occurred in Bosnia before we acted, or we can act. And acting in a situation like this requires a strong stomach, it requires determination, and the confidence to see the policy through. And that is what the President and NATO's leaders have shown. One of the things I've been most impressed by is the fact that all the pictures and the horror stories we've heard in the last 3 days has really only redoubled the determination of all of our NATO allies to hang in there and do the right thing.
But doesn't it worry you that, that you know, as you began to expand targets in Belgrade and in a heavy urban area, that you may find yourself looking at pictures that are of a very different nature?
Well, we're trying our best, and we've been doing our best to limit collateral damage, and we've been able to do that. I mean, let's face it, most of the pictures we've been seeing are the hundreds of thousands of Kosovar Albanians who are suffering at the hands of Milosevic's barbarism, and that's what we've been seeing.
James Rubin is the Assistant Secretary of State at the State Department. I am pleased to have him on this broadcast, as always. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Charlie.
We'll be right back for further analysis of the events in Kosovo. Stay with us. Joining me now to talk about the Kosovo crisis, Laura Silber, United Nations correspondent for the Financial Times. She's the author of a book called Yugoslavia, The Death of a Nation. Also here, Radmilla Milentijevic, former Minister of Information for the Republic of Serbia. I am pleased to have both of them here to have some understanding of a crisis that seems to get larger and larger and larger by day. I turn to Laura Silber. Where are we today? And, you know, and what are the... What does it portend for the future?
I think right now we have three possible scenarios. We have the scenario of sending ground troops, occupying Kosovo, but it will be a Kosovo that's virtually empty. But it will not be a Kosovo that ultimately is part of Yugoslavia. We have also the scenario of ground troops don't come in, yet the fighting goes on and Kosovo is also emptied out. The problem is, what happens with President Milosevic? Is he allowed to stay in office? And what does that mean for
Is it inevitable, you know, that the NATO attacks will be successful?
No, it certainly isn't. But eventually, Serbia, Yugoslavia, will be defeated by NATO. It's a question of time, but clearly, Yugoslavia won't be able to fight in the long term against NATO.
Why was it necessary for Serbia to do what it has done in terms of literally horror stories of Serbian troops or Arkan, or whoever it might be, and his tiger, what do they call him?
Arkan.
Right. Whoever it is responsible, it seems that that effort of violence has intensified against the people of Kosovo.
Well, the bombs really intensified violence incredibly. When you're talking about the horror stories, keep in mind that this is a civil war. And the Yugoslav government is doing exactly what every other government of every other sovereign state in the world would do, has done, or will do in the future, including the United States in our civil war. Civil wars are more destructive than regular wars. But when you talk about ethnic cleansing, when you talk about genocide, I mean, you're using these words, and they have nothing to do with the reality of the situation there. Up to the time of the beginning of the bombing, all newspapers in the West, all the media in the West, all the numbers that we have at hand, talked about 2,000 victims in the war in Kosovo since it started last year in February.
That's about what I hear.
Yeah, yes, absolutely.
Yes. Now, I hear Mr. Rubin talks about genocide, and even President Clinton refers to genocide. As for ethnic cleansing, there has been an effort to push the population from the countryside into the cities. After the experience with Adam Yashari's complex in the Drenica region, where the Serbian forces attacked the complex, and there were large numbers of people who were civilians that were killed, women and children. Not to repeat that kind of experience, from what I understand, the forces have been instructed to tell the areas where the fighting is going to be, where they identify the KLA, the terrorist groups, tell the civilians to move out so that they can take care of the KLA members. Now, until the bombardment, most of the people went to the cities. And cities like Pristina, where you have more than 200,000 Albanians living in the city of Pristina, was a haven for these refugees from the countryside. So was Kosovska Mitrovica, so were other cities, until the bombing started. When the bombing started, they were hitting, for I don't know what reasons, Pristina was hit worse than any other city in Yugoslavia.
Let me move to London there. No one was a better guide for our understanding of Bosnia than Misha Glenny. He has been following this as he followed the Bosnian war and the crisis there and Dayton, and he joins me now from London. Misha, tell me what you think is going on, and are we at a propitious moment now?
Propitious in what sense, Charlie? I'm afraid I can't see anything propitious at all. I think that this is a disastrous situation. I think that the decision by NATO to attack Yugoslavia was extremely ill-conceived for the following reasons. NATO did not properly set a war aim for itself. There have been five or six war aims articulated over the past week by NATO leaders, and it seems that all of those war aims are being undermined by this action, i.e. support for Milosevic is increasing inside Yugoslavia. The main source of opposition to Milosevic's rule in Yugoslavia was Montenegro. Support for Milosevic in Montenegro has been growing and declining for his main opponent, Milo Djukanovic, particularly since NATO had mistaken idea that bombing Montenegro was going to gain support for their action. It clearly hasn't prevented a humanitarian catastrophe. On the contrary, it has accelerated the most appalling humanitarian catastrophe in Kosovo itself, with hundreds of thousands of Albanians suffering the most appalling conditions and threats. And as regards what Mrs. Milentijevic was saying, the killing of Fehmi Agani and the killing of Baton Hadju in cold blood in Pristina has got nothing to do with civil war. It is an absolutely cynical act on the part of Serbian authorities killing moderate Albanian leaders in cold blood. but the other thing which this NATO, ill-conceived NATO action has done is to accelerate the possibility of the war spreading because of the flood of refugees into northern Albania, but particularly into Macedonia, where tensions between the Albanian and Macedonian populations remain high. NATO at the moment is up a creek without a paddle. It doesn't know what it's going to do if Milosevic continues to hold out, which he's extremely likely to do. It cannot get ground troops in. Even if it were to go for a ground troop option, it would take 2 to 3 months to get sufficient troops there. First of all, it has to find the troops. The Americans won't provide them. The Europeans don't have enough. Then it has to assemble them in northern Albania, because it's the only place that you can attack from through the mountains. And by that time, the place will be in utter chaos.
All right, hold one second.
It's a real disaster.
All right, I'm coming back to that. I meant by propitious, just for the record, some sense of whether we had a turning a corner now. I mean,
well, we certainly are, Charlie. Sorry.
Okay. I didn't mean a moment of opportunity for some daylight.
Yes, I understand.
Oh, go ahead. Laura, you want to say what or disagree with what?
Well, actually, I didn't want to disagree with a point, just that Misha might not realize yet, is that apparently that Fehmi Agani and Bajiu may not have been killed, and that what we're hearing in this war of information, misinformation, disinformation, is the last report I read was that, in fact, these two moderate leaders who were part of the negotiating team at Rambouillet were, in fact, seen alive after they reported dead. And I think that just attests to the situation is so horrible that what actually... we don't know what's true and what's not. What we do know is, as Misha's pointed out, there are appalling cases of people being sent on forced march. There are certainly mass killings, but we don't know the extent of it, and that's one of the greatest problems right now, is we don't know exactly what we're dealing with. I think one of the things is that what Misha was pointing to also that's very important is looking with Montenegro is that Milosevic not only support growing for him, but more importantly, Milosevic will use this as an opportunity to settle scores with the moderate pro-Western leadership in Montenegro. He's going to try and get rid of him, as he will try to take account with all people who think other than him in Serbia.
I want to bring you in. Let me go back one second before we go that. Just to touch on something that you said, Misha, are you suggesting that NATO, with all of its power and with all the member nations of NATO involved in this, that in the end they don't have the will nor the capacity to force Milosevic to come to terms?
I don't think that they have sufficient military tactics or the proper military strategies, but because of the politicians who excluded a priori the use of ground troops. I mean, this is such an elementary mistake that they made. Personally, I think that, NATO should have thought much, much more carefully about doing this, but also have had a proper political, coherent political strategy to go with the bombing, and also a military strategy which was not bound to fail. Bombing on its own has never, ever done it.
Well,
and there's no reason why it should do it now.
But let me just make sure I hear you out, though, because you add another element to it. Suppose the tactics had been right, a combination of air and troops and the right political strategy and mission definition. It was a doable action, was it not?
Well, it was probably doable from a military point of view, although that remains a moot point. but it also would still have contained enormous dangers from a political point of view, not the least of which is the knock-on effect it's going to have in terms of deterioration in relations with Russia. but overall, it's another sort of... the whole concept, which was argued as NATO had to maintain its credibility without actually properly knowing what it was doing, seems to me based on a false premise.
Well, it seems to me, though, that...
There's a lot of rethinking to do here.
I'll come to Radmilla. It seems to me that the credibility is even more now on the line, and that's part of the problem you have.
That's the irony. There was a senior European politician went to Washington about 10 days before before this action started, and he told people in Washington, senior government officials, that the alternative to shooting yourself in the foot is not to do it. The officials responded to him that it was all a matter of NATO's credibility on the line, and so they had to do it. What looks extremely likely an outcome on the 50th birthday of NATO is that this whole operation will undermine NATO's credibility fatally.
You wanted to say?
Yeah, I would not argue what NATO is going to do. They can change their minds. The utmost question in our minds, in the Serbian mind today, is why is the United States bombing the Serbian people? Why is the United States destroying Yugoslavia? The Serbian people who fought together with the American people in two world wars in this century, who were devoted allies, who during World War II held down more than 120,000 German troops and made that contribution to the victory of the Allies.
You know what the Americans would say? They'd say we're bombing Serbians because their leader will not come to an agreement, A, for some version of autonomy. Their leader allows countenance. Is part of a kind of ethnic cleansing akin to what happened in Bosnia, and having seen the West suffer from the moral criticism of that, they're not willing to sit by again.
May I just respond to this with just a few words? Talking about morality and ethnic cleansing, the West didn't do anything. The United States did nothing when Mr. Tudjman in August 95
absolutely.
Attacked and expelled more than 200,000 Serbs absolutely. Who fought for independence,
you're
who wanted to stay
right.
with Yugoslavia. And we did nothing.
Yeah, can I come in there,
yes,
Charlie?
Please. Yes.
Can I come in there, Charlie?
Yes, and then
that's perfectly true. And I've always been deeply critical of what happened to the Serbs of the Krajina. And to the Serbs, some of the Serbs in Bosnia-Herzegovina as well. To use that, however, to use the suffering of the Serbs of the Krajina in order to justify cleansing the Albanians of Kosovo, I think is an obscenity. The overall point about this is surely that, yes, I agree with Laura that Milosevic has persistently destabilized the region. He has had allies in doing that, like President Tudjman in Croatia. The KLA itself is, in my opinion, a destabilizing force. There's no question about that. But also, throughout the last 10 years, the West, which has become deeply involved in this crisis, has responded piecemeal to each situation. It has not come up with any principled response to what's going on. And you have different constitutional and political solutions for Croatia, for Bosnia, now for Serbia, presumably in the future for Macedonia. And I think there must come a time when representatives of the West and representatives of the region sit down and work out how we can get, I'm talking long term now, how we can start to integrate this part of Europe, an integral part of Europe, into our community so that people no longer have to put up with this ghastly civilian strife there.
Yeah, but I thought that's part of what your friend Ambassador Holbrooke was trying to do.
Well, no, I mean, basically, Dick Holbrooke is the guy who goes in at the last minute and tries to knock things on the head, but it's part of that piecemeal response. I'm not saying he's responsible for the piecemeal response.
But I'm saying
it's the whole process. From the question of the recognition of Slovenia and Croatia onwards,
right.
About how we respond, what principles we apply. I mean, Serbia does have a point that Kosovo is part of Serbia. And this is a different response from the way we responded in Bosnia and the way we responded in Croatia.
But there is my impression that the President Clinton, and we'll know more, he spoke earlier this evening, but as we tape, we don't know what he said to Dan Rather on CBS and on CBS 60 Minutes 2. But my impression is that the president, in a sense, has moved beyond some sense of autonomy, that they're so fed up with the way things are going that the circumstances have moved beyond autonomy to something else, which is a denial of whatever the historic link between Serbia and Kosovo was.
Well, certainly the Paris peace plan and Rambouillet are dead. They are dead in the water.
So what
Something
is alive,
new has
then?
Got to happen. Whether it's going to, I mean, if the Americans now want to sort of say, we're going to fight on for Albanian independence in Kosovo now, and we want it as as soon as possible. I think, you know, before they go ahead and do that sort of thing, I gather that in the Congress there's some talk about the idea of training and arming the KLA as a guerrilla force, with the NATO being used as its as air force, and supporting an insurgency war in Kosovo. I mean, I think all that sort of talk comes out of CIA manuals from the 1960s.
Well, that was a recommendation, I think, by Senator Lieberman of Connecticut. And
that's going to end in tragedy. That is, I mean, you know.
Well, the whole thing's going to end in tragedy the way it's going.
Absolutely.
Is it
Absolutely.
Not?
Yeah, no. I mean, it's a complete tragedy now.
But
NATO has shot itself in the foot, and frankly, it's up to NATO politicians now to clear the thing up. I'm sure Laura will agree with me on this. That in 1996, in February and April, when the KLA emerged for the first time, and that a part of the Albanian population had finally become fed up with the passive resistance techniques which weren't working, and the Serbs were still discriminating against them systematically, they decided to take up weapons. As soon as that happened, that was when, if the West was going to respond effectively diplomatically, that it should have become involved.
Absolutely.
And it was obvious to everyone watching the situation there, and the West just sat back and waited for the situation to deteriorate until February and March of last year. And then it had a whole different ball game on its hands, and it evidently wasn't capable of dealing with it.
Absolutely. I think they've been playing catch-up, and I think one of the important things, Misha, and I'm sure you would agree here, is that when, even before the episodes with the KLA, soon after Dayton, soon after Dick Holbrooke had so successfully put all that pressure on Milosevic, we should have turned and said, let's get a settlement. Let's start working towards a settlement, some sort of political settlement in Kosovo. But instead what happened was we sat back, waited for the situation to get worse, and now, of course, there is no Rambouillet. I think there's no independence, there's no autonomy for Kosovo. I think it is independence. But the question is, and I think this is the question they're asking themselves in Washington and elsewhere, is what then? Does that mean everything has to be renegotiated? And what would a greater Albania mean for stability in the Balkans?
And what are the Kurds going to ask for next?
Absolutely.
Et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
Not only Kurds, the Hungarians in Romania, 2 million of them who wanted political autonomy did not get it, they got only cultural autonomy. There are Turks in Bulgaria. It's a big problem. My suggestion, you know, for wherever it is worth, stop the bombing. Go for the highest degree of autonomy according to the highest European and world standards for Kosovo. But above all, leave the sanctions and let the economy begin to develop, because one of the big problems in Kosovo we have, 80%, 90% of the population, these young people who have taken on the arms now, have no jobs, no future. The same goes for Serbia. When Madeleine Albright talks about democracy, the sanctions have destroyed the middle classes in Serbia, and the middle class is the carrier of democracy.
Then would you urge Milosevic to sign on to autonomy today?
Yes, with the amendments. There are a couple of things that we are asking. One of which is, this is not Dayton. This says for 3 years, and then after 3 years, everything is up for grabs. And when the Albanians came back from Paris signing off on it, they said, "Pooh! After 3 years, we'll have our way." So make this permanent and try not to force Serbia to be occupied by NATO, but look for some solution through the United Nations, some peacekeeping force of the United Nations, because the United Nations, under the charter, has this responsibility.
Last word, Misha. What should we look for next?
Well, I think that at some point, as far as I'm concerned, sooner rather than later, the bombing has got to stop and should stop. I also think that the Serbs should commit itself to pulling a large part of the forces in Kosovo out. And I think that if you want to start thinking about some sort of solution whereby it's guaranteed by military force, you could suggest, say, a joint force of Russians, Greeks, and 2 Western countries in order to give people a bit of breathing space. Whether it's autonomy or independence, I don't know. I'm very pleased to hear that the Serbian government now considers autonomy a viable option for the Albanians. I think it's just a pity that they didn't agree to it 3 or 4 years ago, or possibly even better, not have touched it in 1989 in the first place.
All right. Thank you very much. Misha Glenny is in London. Laura Silber here. Her book, again, is called Yugoslavia, The Death of a Nation. Also here, Radmilla Milentijevic. Thank you for joining us. We'll see you tomorrow night. Our special guest for the hour, Quincy Jones.
Cisco Systems, the company that brought the internet to business, is pleased to help bring The Charlie Rose Show to PBS. Cisco Systems, empowering the internet generation.
Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
To order Charlie Rose program transcripts and video cassettes, call 1-800-ALL-NEWS or write to the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest.
This is PBS.
Politicians,
business leaders,